After Dark in the Playing Fields by M.R. James, narrated by Peter Coates. The hour was late and the night was fair. I had halted not far from Sheep's Bridge and was thinking about the stillness, only broken by the sound of the weir, when a loud, tremulous hoot just above me made me jump. It is always annoying to be startled, but I have a kindness for owls. This one was evidently very near. I looked about for it. There it was, sitting plumply on a branch about 12 feet up. I pointed my stick at it and said, "Was that you?" "Drop it," said the owl. "I know it ain't only a stick, but I don't like it. Yes, of course it was me. Who do you suppose it would be if it weren't?" We will take as read the sentences about my surprise. I lowered the stick. "Well," said the owl, "what about it? If you will come out here of a midsummer evening like what this is, what do you expect?" "I beg your pardon," I said, "I should have remembered. May I say that I think myself very lucky to have met you tonight? I hope you have time for a little talk." "Well," said the owl ungraciously, "I don't know as it matters so particular tonight. I've had me supper, as it happens, and if you went too long over it—" "Ah!" Suddenly it broke into a loud scream, flapped its wings furiously, bent forward and clutched its perch tightly, continuing to scream. Plainly something was pulling hard at it from behind. The strain relaxed abruptly, the owl nearly fell over, and then whipped round, ruffling up all over, and made a vicious dab at something unseen by me. "Oh, I am sorry," said a small, clear voice, in a solicitous tone. "I made sure it was loose. I do hope I didn't hurt you."
"Didn't hurt me," said the owl bitterly. "Of course you hurt me, and well you know it, you young infidel. That feather was no more loose than, oh, if I could get at you. Now I shouldn't wonder but what you've throwed me all out of balance. Why can't you let a person sit quiet for 2 minutes at a time without you must come creeping up and, well, you've done it this time anyway. I shall go straight to headquarters and—" finding it was now addressing the empty air, "why, where have you got to now? Oh, it's too bad, that it is."
"Dear me," I said, "I'm afraid this isn't the first time you've been annoyed in this way. May I ask exactly what happened?"
"Yes, you may ask," said the owl, still looking narrowly about as it spoke. "But it'd take me till the latter end of next week to tell you. Fancy coming and pulling out anyone's tail feather. Hurt me something cruel it did. And what for, I should like to know? Answer me that. Where's the reason of it?"
All that occurred to me was to murmur, "The clamorous owl that nightly hoots and wonders at our quaint spirits." I hardly thought the point would be taken, but the owl said sharply,
"What's that? Yes, you needn't to repeat it. I heard, and I'll tell you what's at the bottom of it, and you mark my words."
It bent towards me and whispered, with many nods of its round head,
"Pride, standoffishness, that's what it is. Come not near our fairy queen."
This in a tone of bitter contempt.
"Oh dear, no, we aren't good enough for the likes of them. Us that's been noted time out of mind for the best singers in the fields. Now, ain't that so?"
"Well," I said doubtfully enough, "I like to hear you very much, but you know, some people think a lot of the thrushes and nightingales and so on. You must have heard of that, haven't you? And then perhaps, of course I don't know, perhaps your style of singing isn't exactly what they think suitable to accompany their dancing, eh?"
"I should kindly hope not," said the owl, drawing itself up. "Our family's never given in to dancing, nor never won't neither. Why, whatever are you thinking of?"
it went on with rising temper.
"A pretty thing it would be for me to sit here hiccuping at them."
It stopped and looked cautiously around it and up and down, and then continued in a louder voice.
"Them little ladies and gentlemen, if it ain't suitable for them, I'm very sure it ain't suitable for me. And—" temper rising again, "if they expect me never to say a word just because they're dancing and carrying on with their foolishness, they're very much mistook, and so I tell 'em."
From what had passed before, I was afraid this was an imprudent line to take, and I was right. Hardly had the owl given its last emphatic nod when four small slim forms dropped from a bough above, and in a twinkling—
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.